Good morning. Welcome back to the Broadcast Retirement Network. This is BRN Weekly for Saturday, April 13th, 2024. And our top story today is recent inflation data still supportive of Fed rate cuts. And joining me now to discuss this and a lot more, Jane King is a financial journalist joining us from the NASDAQ. Jane, so great to see you. Thanks so much for joining us on the program again this morning.
Great to be back, Jeffrey.
All right, let's talk about inflation numbers. We kind of teed this up last week, you know, the tea leaves, jobs, had good jobs numbers, maybe a little bit perspective different when you look in the details of the job numbers. This week, you told us to watch out for inflation, and we've got some hot inflation data.
We did. So, of course, we get those back-to-back consumer prices and producer prices the next day. And the consumer prices, that was the one that really rocked the market. So it came in hotter than expected, not by a lot, but this is the third month in a row that we have had hotter than expected inflation. And I remember economists in January being, January is kind of weird. It's probably just a one-month thing. You know, let's see where we are in February, March. Well, here we are. And we're still seeing hot inflation numbers. And car insurance up 22% over the past year. That was huge. But we also saw energy go up, electricity, of course, housing. That's been a problem for a while now. Clothing was up. So a lot of things were higher. A couple things were down. Used car prices fell. Airplane tickets actually fell. So, but the overall basket of consumer items is continuing to be stubbornly high.
Yeah, and all our conversation last week and into this week is, what will the Federal Reserve do? I feel like every week we're having this type of conversation. Yeah. When are we going to get rate cuts? We knew that Q1 rate cuts are off the table. I think in talking with you and other folks we've had on the network with you, that maybe June was the right time. What's the outlook now for these interest rate cuts, which are the basis for federal funds lending? The markets really are dependent on what interest rates are going to be.
Well, that's like guiding everything lately. So when this CPI number came out, I believe the June chances of rate cut fell to like 18% or something. So that immediately dropped. So it'd be the second half of the year if we do get one. But increasingly, I'm hearing people say, you know, maybe we won't get any interest rate cuts, and maybe we shouldn't. In particular, if we get another month or two of numbers like this, I don't think they'll cut interest rates this year.
Is there a risk, Jane, for interest rate hike, or you know, what are you hearing from your contacts in the market? You know, could that be an appetite if things get too hot? I mean, I guess that puts the next report on the hot seat in terms of what happens, but could we see the Fed go in the other direction, raising interest rates?
I think anything is possible. I do think we'd have to see another few months of inflation be hotter than expected, not by just a 10th of a percent, but maybe even more, enough that would shock the system a little bit. So, you know, I think anything is possible, and we'll just go month to month, really, is what we can do at this point.
Yeah. Jane, you talked about the consumer basket. What about the producer? Can't get it out. The producer price index. So producers have to buy goods to make the goods. That includes wages and raw materials. How about the PPI? How's all this impact the producers out there?
So that was 2.1%, the producer prices. So not as scary as the CPI number. They don't have the same costs that, you know, consumers do, you know, probably not 22% increase in car insurance and things like that. So that was a little, you know, reassuring to the market. And typically those producer price index increases become consumer increases 3 or 4 months down the road. So I think there was some optimism that, you know, maybe we've seen the high with consumer prices, but we'll just wait and see.
Yeah. And you mentioned in the CPI number, gasoline prices on the uptick. And now there's a lot of consternation going on in the Middle East, continuing to go on. Things are kind of heating up even more. That's having an impact on the cost of, or the projected cost of oil, the futures of oil. That directly impacts the cost of gasoline, because it's the cost to buy the oil. You've then got to refine it. And then, so gasoline prices going up around the country.
They are. And we're seeing oil nearing $90 a barrel. So, and energy stocks have outperformed tech stocks so far this year. So, and they pay nice dividends. So there you go.
Absolutely. And I did see that. I mean, I guess, as you said, it's a wait and see. Jane, thanks so much for popping by the program. We look forward to having you back on the program again next week.
We'll see you then.
Thanks, Jane. Great to see you. Thanks for sharing your perspective. And when we come back, we take a look back at some of our best segments for the week. Imagine a new television network that will make you richer, healthier, and in control of your financial future. This network is for the policewoman in Nashville, Tennessee, the baker in Dubuque, Iowa, the teacher in Lexington, Kentucky. We want to make the idea of savings and retirement culturally relevant. But what do you see as a defining issue of the midterms?
Especially for the smaller businesses, I mean, they are the lifeblood of the American economy.
Featuring exclusive interviews, current affairs, and docuseries. 33 years old, you retired early.
The philosophy is money only matters if it helps you live a life that you love.
But you gotta start thinking about retirement as soon as you get in.
The Broadcast Retirement Network will drive very high engagement with premium partnerships. So this isn't retirement and savings for your parents or grandparents. This is for all Americans. And we're gonna change the way you think about money. Welcome to the next frontier of retirement and savings. This is BRN, the Broadcast Retirement Network. Welcome back. Well, it was another great week of great topics and, of course, great guests. We kick off the week with a look at why we still need cash. Let's take a look.
I would say we still need it. The point of money, whatever form of money you have, is to make commerce more efficient, to make your transactions run more efficiently. And so I think it's good that we now have gotten to a point where we have multiple means of payment, right? Back in the old days, it was cold hard cash, and then they invented checks, right? And they had old banknotes and stuff along the way. And now we've got all this electronic stuff. We've got credit cards and debit cards and Venmo and all that other. That just adds more options to people so that whatever works better for them, they can use. Well, I'll start with the pennies. I think we probably don't need them. And you can see the fact that people just don't use them very much, right? The problem with the penny isn't simply that it costs more money to mint a penny than the penny's worth. Even if they could make a penny out of like thin air, right? And so it costs nothing to produce it. Think about how much time it takes a person to use a penny in a transaction. And with the average wage in the United States being over $30 an hour, basically the average person in the US time is worth about 1 cent for every 2 seconds. So if it's taking you 2 seconds to fish into your pocket and get your penny out, it's a loss right there. And then on top of that is the cost of minting it and lugging it around. And so what do people do with their pennies? They do like my wife does. They just put them in a jar when you get home. So I have been consciously going into that jar the last month or so. When I Sunday morning, I go on a walk and it brings me by a grocery store and I pick up a gallon of milk and I've been just taking change out of there. And I've been feeding in it one penny at a time. And I think even when I got them sitting in my hand, taking them out and putting them in, it takes me at least a second of my time holding up. Well, it's Sunday morning, so there's not much of a line. And I do the self-serve checkout thing. If I was in a regular line with people, it'd be wasting my time and their time and the cashier's time and all that kind of stuff. So it's the waste of time that's the bigger thing on top of the cost of minting them and moving them around. And because we don't even bring them back, then the stores say, hey, we're out of pennies. And the news gets sent up to the mint and they mint more of these things up, which of course uses real resources. It's primarily zinc. And, there's environmental damages and things from that as well. So all in all, I think probably we should get rid of the penny. A lot of other similar countries have gotten rid of their penny. Canada did. A lot of the countries that use the euro have gotten rid of the cent. And the problem with the United States is if you literally read the Constitution, it says that Congress has the power to decide, you know, what is our money. So it would take an act of Congress. Congress is so busy with all the other things they do that I don't see them acting anytime soon. There was a congressman who introduced a bill to do it. I actually went up and visited his office. This was probably 10 years ago now. He's retired. And he got like three co-sponsors. And that was it. And it never came up for a vote. So Congress is just too busy. The Mint, I guess, could act unilaterally and just say, hey, Congress, unless you say otherwise, we're just going to stop minting these things up. And then slowly the penny could go away. But the Mint, I guess, doesn't feel like they've got the legitimacy to do that. And so I think we're just going to be stuck with pennies as inflation happens and prices go up, the penny just loses value over time. I think there are a range of people with a range of different attitudes toward money, and some of them use their phone or whatever exclusively. But there's plenty of people who don't, and they like having physical cash around. I've heard people even say that it doesn't even feel like you're spending when you just flash that little thing. And you're more careful spending when you're dealing with, you know, physical pieces of paper and coins and stuff. So that might be a benefit. But again, as I said earlier, I like it. I would like it. I think most economists would like it if we have the kinds of monies that people are comfortable using. That'll make. And so there's plenty of occasions where it's nice to have just cash around. Right. Like you go to church and they pass the collection plate. I know you can do, ahead of time and do it all electronically and stuff. But when I see that collection plate going around at my church, I see a number of people putting cash in. You go to farmers markets. I know many of the people will have like a little device right there on their attached to their phone or something where you can swipe a card, but not everybody does. And then I was talking to a reporter a week or two ago. She's from Puerto Rico. Remember when Hurricane Maria hit Puerto Rico and they're in entire electrical system went out, and the people who had cash on hands could actually buy some things, and the other people who were stuck with electronic forms of money actually couldn't. So it's nice to have backups. It's nice to. The other thing is, cash gives you anonymity. Some people see that as a bad thing, like people who want to track what you're spending, the powers that be who want to spy on you. They'd like to know every dollar you're spending. But some people like anonymity, so it's nice to be able to pay in cash sometimes, even though I know that, you know, a lot of illegal transactions can be done anonymously with cash as well.
Next up, we discussed paying down that credit card debt. Let's take a look.
Before the pandemic, the credit card balances or credit card debt for the country was at about $1 trillion. Now, what happened was during the pandemic, people weren't using their credit cards. They weren't traveling. They weren't going out to eat. They also were getting a ton of money from the government. So that $1 trillion in credit card debt got paid down to about a 500 billion, half, a 50% drop. The challenge now is that that same credit card debt is now at 1.1 trillion, and it's likely to exceed $1.5 trillion in the next few years. So what that's telling us at debt.com is that people are using their credit cards to make up for the deficits in their budget because things have gone up due to inflation. Gas has gone up, food prices have gone up, everything has gone up, and the people's wages have not increased that substantially to pay for it all. So they're using the credit cards as a form of supplemental income. The younger folks do have credit card debt, but they also don't have the earnings to justify significant credit balances or credit available credit allowances from the creditors. The older folks are tending to have higher debt and certainly into retirement, they're retiring with debt. We never saw that 20 years ago. I mean, here and there we would see it, but most people that were in retirement or going towards retirement got into debt for a number of reasons. The most likely one was they were helping out their children, and that they pulled down some significant debt. Nowadays, the people are retiring with debt with no ambition or no hope of paying it off, because as you retire, your income typically is reduced. And that is challenging for a lot of people, especially in retirement. So that is concerning me, because what that says is, how are these people going to pay off their debt? The answer is they're not. They're going to die with unsecured debt. The estate is responsible for paying that debt off. So basically, it's not your beneficiaries, but whoever's managing the estate. If there's assets, they're responsible for paying that debt. If there are no assets or not enough assets, that debt dies with you, and there's nobody to collect from. And let's face it, people that are passing away and that are in retirement that have debt, there's a reason why they have debt, because they don't have assets. They don't have money to pay for that debt or pay for those expenses. So the credit card companies are not very aggressive at going after debt of deceased credit holders. So that is a challenge, certainly. We're in a capitalist society, and credit cards are capital in nature. And the reason why I'm saying that is, whether there's a bunch of people defaulting or not, those credit card companies, their sole purpose is to maximize profit. So they're going to charge you as much interest as you possibly can without you walking and moving your debt to another card lender. And they're going to hit you with every fee possible under the sun. So it's not like, the government. When somebody doesn't pay, other people will pick up. In lending, there's a certain amount of likelihood, and in your projections, that certain people will not pay. And that goes into their business model. It could be 5% of the people don't pay. It could be 30% of the people don't pay, depending on what subset of debtor you're going after. But that's all built into the rates. So if one group falls off, doesn't matter. They're still going to maximize their interest rates.
And that wraps up this episode of BRN Weekly. Have a topic of interest, someone you think we should talk to? Then drop us a line. And don't forget, for all the latest curated news and lifestyle, wellness, finance, tech, so much more, all in one place, check out today's edition of our daily newsletter, The Morning Pulse. Want to search our archives, check out our latest content? Well, then visit our website. Hey, we're back again tomorrow with another edition of BRN Sunday. I'll be joined by the Legal Eagles, David Levine and Kevin Walsh, and also Oliver Rennick of the Schwab Network, as we seek to make sense of the week that was in retirement markets and so much more. So until then, I'm Jeff Snyder. Stay safe, keep on saving, and don't forget, roll with the changes. Now is your opportunity to co-create content around any topic on the First Lifestyle and Wellness Network. Reach a global audience through our platform and co-own exclusive branded content. All of our programs are available on demand and also as audio-only podcasts, so you can take us on the go. Broadcast Retirement Network, available anytime, anywhere, and on any device.